I'm going to open up our Bibles, please, to Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. And we'll go ahead and pray and ask the Lord for help with our Sunday school lesson here this morning. Heavenly Father, God, thank you, Lord, for this morning, and thank you for this chance for us to come together here at Bible Baptist Church to learn more about you, Father, and your word. And Lord, I just ask you to fill us with the Holy Ghost to be able to illuminate us with regards to the results of justification this morning. And Lord, we give you thanks and praise for all things, especially for that salvation which was wrought through your Son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. And this morning we'll continue our studies here in the Epistle of Romans. And we saw last week in chapter 4, he gave his example with Abraham about imputation. Okay. And he talked about how the Lord was delivered for our offenses and raised again for our justification. And then he says, to conclude, chapter 5, verse 1, therefore, and there you go, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand, and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And so this morning, we're going to find out some things that God has given to us because we have been justified by faith. That is, we're going to look at the results of justification. Okay? This is the beginning of the portion of the doctrine of Christ here in Romans. This usually shows the difference between the standing of a Christian and their state when you go into like basic discipleship. Standing is when you get justified. How do you look in front of God judicially? Okay, and if you've received Jesus Christ, your Lord and Savior, you're good to go. We've seen that, and it's pretty clear. Okay? You've received the righteousness of God, which is by faith. But because of that justification, now, Christian, you have a new beginning. You are born again. You have a new right to life here. Okay? And you, just like you did before, you had a decision to come to Jesus to save you. You also have a decision to come to Jesus to make you more holy, to sanctify you. And that has to do with your state. How is your walk with Jesus? Okay. And so we're going to begin looking at that because the reality is justification gives you the ability to actually live for God. Okay. We just read here in verses 1 and 2, we saw that because we're justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's think about that for a second. Okay. Justification does not give you world peace. That's the first thing I want to make clear. Okay. Many people think, oh, because Jesus Christ did this work already at Calvary, it just like blanketly applies to the world and we're good to go. We're just having trouble manifesting it in our state in the world. So they try to make things better. Okay. No, this is individual to every person. Okay. And it's true that because you are justified, you stop being God's enemy. You have peace with Him. You have become His child. Praise God. Okay. And it's because you have the righteousness of His Son living in your heart. Now, how clear is God about whether or not people without Him can have peace? He's pretty blunt. Okay. Go to Isaiah 32. Isaiah 32, please. I'll quote Isaiah 48, verse 22, which is on the board. It just says, there is no peace, saith my God, for the wicked, or to the wicked. Isaiah 32, verse 17. That's the reality. They may talk about trying to get world peace, and they may talk about a personal peace they feel because they decided to become a Wiccan, or they decided to reveal what they truly believe they are. You know, today the big topic is obviously sodomy, among other things. Okay? None of that is true peace. There's no peace, saith our God, for the wicked. Yeah, that's just a fact. And it's because they have no idea what's going to happen once their heart stops beating. They have no clue about the reality of the world. They're stuck in the right now. Is all they know. But then Isaiah 32 verse 17, notice what God says here, and He says, and the work of righteousness shall be peace. No, it's kind of like a prophecy. Jesus Christ worked the work of righteousness in you, and that's why you got justified. And the result of that is peace. You have peace with God. See that? Continue on. And the effect of righteousness, the results of justification, is what? Quietness and assurance forever. Do you know that you have eternal life? God promised that way back here in Isaiah. See that? We talk about eternal security. That's just our fancy doctrinal term for eternal assurance. That's what the Bible calls it. Okay? Are you assured? Are you persuaded that God can keep you to that which he hath committed unto you against that day? Do you know you have eternal life? Okay? It's not a hope-so thing, as we discussed last week. And that's the effects of recognizing the truth about justification. If you understand it, you'll know you're standing. And what's the problem with most Christianity? They don't understand justification. So they keep thinking they're working to keep it and stuff. Completely messed the entire book of Romans. Okay? That's really all you have to do. If you talk to somebody who thinks he's a leader in the faith over there in holiness or whatever, just bring up justification and talk to them about it. They don't understand that basic doctrine that Baptists have gotten for years. Okay? Why? I don't know. It's pretty clear, right? Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God. It had nothing to do with me. It had nothing to do with my works. It's by faith. Okay? And so that peace you have with God has remedied the situation with your soul and your relationship with him, because now he's your father. And that's the big change. That's the difference. The reason why the wicked don't have peace is because they continue to be enemies of the Lord. They haven't reconciled themselves to him. Okay? But because you've received that, Christian, you now have entered into the kingdom of God. And the Bible says in Romans 14, verse 17, for the kingdom of God, notice, it's not meat and drink. It's not physical stuff. Don't think of the kingdom of heaven. Don't think of Old Testament. So you can see all this confusion today, trying to take Old Testament stuff. That's not what the kingdom of God is. What it is righteousness, God Jesus. Peace, the peace you get from the justification he gives you, and joy, which we're about to read about in a second. And the Holy Ghost. Okay. The reason why the world will not get peace is because they won't receive the Lord, who is their righteousness first. They want the peace without God's righteousness. Okay. In Luke 2, the angel said, glory to God in the highest, and then peace and goodwill toward men. They have it backwards. They want the peace and goodwill without the righteousness, without giving glory to God. It's not going to happen, gentlemen, ladies. Okay. Sorry. How can you have peace without the creator of the universe who made your heart and is the one that can actually tune it to make sure that peace is manifest in your heart and in your mind and all the parts of your body and soul? Okay. And so because of this justification we have, we read in verse 2, that we have access by the faith into this grace that Jesus Christ gave us, wherein we stand. That's where standing comes from. It's not right there. We stand in the reality that we're justified. Okay? Now, what's interesting about this, you have access to God through this. And that's a very, very unique thing, okay? Especially to a Jew. Go to Leviticus 16. Okay? As close as they were to God, the fact they had the oracles, all these things, they did not have this kind of access that you have, Christian. Okay? You have a familial bond with God that they simply did not share. At best, they could become God's friend, which we've read many times. Same thing with Abraham. But trust me, Abraham today, since now his sin is clean off his soul, okay, at least for the standard doctrine anyway, yeah, he's God's child as well. Okay. Leviticus 16, in verse 1, please. We're going to read something about the high priest, the one who we would think would be the closest to God in all ways, right? Notice what he had to do in the Old Testament to even have a chance to step into the throne where God was, to get into his presence. Leviticus 16 and verse 1. And the Lord spake unto Moses after the death of the two sons of Aaron, when they offered before the Lord and died. And the Lord said unto Moses, speak unto Aaron thy brother, that he come not at all times into the holy place within the veil before the mercy seat. That's the most holy place. Which is upon the ark. Why, Lord? What is he going to tell you? That he die not, for I will appear in the cloud upon the mercy seat. God's going to be there, his presence. Thus shall Aaron come into the holy place with a young bullock for a sin offering and a ram for a burnt offering. He needs to provide offerings for his sins before he even has the capacity to be in fellowship with God in his presence in the most holy place. Christian, you've received the actual manifestation of the true sacrifice, the true Passover, Jesus Christ. And that's why he doesn't just give you remission, because you're going to find out they had to repeat this yearly. Okay? You have redemption. Your sins are taken away. You don't have to do it any more than one time. Standing. Judgments work that way. Okay, except for Roe versus Wade. Praise the Lord. I'm glad they reversed that. Okay? That was a judgment that people thought would hold forever. Okay? God's judgments actually do. That's the difference. Okay? Man make mistakes, and I thank God for that change. Okay, but when God judges you, he ain't going to take that back. The gifts and calling of God are without repentance. Okay? And so, Christian, because you're born again and you're part of the church of God, you can enter into this throne with no issue. You don't have to be like Aaron, even though he was the high priest of the Jews. Okay? In Hebrews 4, verse 16, let's go there. Hebrews 4, verse 16. We're just stressing the reality. You need to recognize that you have access to God. So what do you do with that? You talk to him. You call to him. You go to him before anybody else. Okay? Even your husband or wife. Okay? Hebrews 4, verse 16. The Bible says, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace. That's how you should come. Okay, the Holy Ghost will give you boldness to decide to come directly to God for questions, for needs, for comfort, for grace, especially when you're in a trial. That we may obtain mercy, that's to make sure you can get through the trial here on earth, and find grace to pass it and turn it into a good to help in time of need. Okay. We have access by faith in this grace wherein we stand, the Bible says. And so, Christian, this is where the idea of the priesthood of the believer comes from. Because of the access you have, you can pray to God. And you can pray to God for others. That's what priests do. Yeah. But unlike Aaron, you can just walk into the most holy place through the eye of faith. Yeah. And then because of that access you have, you also have a hope, okay, that was given to you. Now, we saw last week that that hope of God actually is the Lord, right? It's Jesus. He's your hope, you see? And so what we have to remember is that the reason why we have all these things is because of him. We always turn back to him first and foremost. We don't have any of these things because we're special, okay? Much to the chagrin of the world who keeps thinking we think we're special, okay? No, they can have all these things if they simply come to God and stop trying to be his enemy. Okay. So what does this look like? Go to Ephesians 2. Ephesians 2. In Ephesians 2 verse 11, this shows you a general statement about our race here, the Gentiles. And this was the reality before Christ. Okay. This is why if you wanted to come to God before Jesus Christ did his work, you would have had to become a Jewish proselyte. Okay, like Nicholas. Ephesians 2, verse 11, wherefore remember, and Paul wants you to keep that in mind, how unique our situation is today, that ye being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hands, that at that time ye were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope, and without God in the world. Notice the connection. Your hope is God manifest in the flesh. There was a time where we didn't have any hope. Okay, but now the change in Christ Jesus, ye who were sometimes were far off are made nigh by the blood of Christ. Okay. And so what you'll learn in your studies is, as you continue on, Christian, is the reality of the mysteries of God that we're to be stewards of. And one of them is in Colossians 1 verse 26, where it talks about Christ in you, the hope of glory. God now lives in you through the new birth, and he's your hope because your whole purpose in life in trying to adjust your state is to make Jesus manifest through your life so others see him. Okay? They're still going to see you, okay? But it'll be like something happened to you. Okay? What's going on there, brother? Okay? Or, you know, people work, Casey, why are you acting all different? Okay? That kind of stuff. You tell them, oh, Jesus, that's all you got to do. Just keep reminding them. Okay? This is the idea. Okay. And so go to 1 Thessalonians 5. 1 Thessalonians 5. If he's your hope, show him to people. Okay. Because remember, his hope can work against the hope of the world. His hope can make people recognize the reality. They don't have to guess whether they're going to heaven. They can know it. Yeah? Just like Abraham was able to believe against the impossibility of having children at his age. Okay? We can believe in the impossibility of being able to know you can go to heaven despite our sinfulness. See that? 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 8. But let us who are of the day, which you are now, you're standing as you're of the day, be sober. But you got to make this choice now. Be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love. Okay, so now you got the protection here in your chest where your heart is. Your heart is protected. You have the standing. You know it. Okay, and for an helmet to cover up your head, to work on your mind, the hope of salvation. Jesus Christ should be affecting your mind. He should be renewing your mind. I'm getting ahead of Paul in Romans. Okay? But he's setting up for this. See that? Okay? He gives the generalities and he gets into the particulars. For those who know how writing usually works. Okay? This is what's going on. Go back to Romans 3, or Romans 5, excuse me. Romans 5. Good basic teaching today, but very, very important. Okay. What should drive you to live for God? Because God promised He would make sure you can live for Him. And He gave you the capacity to do it. And He desires to do it. He just asks you to trust Him and give yourself to Him. Have faith. Romans 5, verses 3 through 5, then it says, and not only so, but we glory in tribulations also. Okay, so why do you rejoice in the hope of the glory of God? You're about to see. Okay? Knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. Okay? Now, we're to glory in our tribulations also. What's going on there? This doesn't make sense. It's almost like Paul is telling you, look, because you know you're standing, recognize that your state is going to include tribulations in life. Okay? The peace you get with God doesn't take away problems in life. It gives you the way to deal with the issue and pass it and become greater and overcome it and have a victory. Okay? Now notice, Paul didn't just make this up. Jesus Christ actually told his disciples in John 16. Let's go there. John 16. And a common theme that we've been seeing in Romans is that Paul didn't make up anything. He just built on the Lord's foundation, just like we're all supposed to do. Keep in mind, Jesus Christ taught him all this stuff. It's very strange when these heretics come around and try to tell you that Paul, you know, contradicted Jesus. What are you talking about? Okay? You probably did the most superficial Bible study I've ever seen in my life. Okay, almost like the devil. Okay, John 16, verse 31. That's how the devil reads the Bible, by the way. He gets no understanding. He doesn't have the Spirit of God. Okay. Jesus answered them, after all that great stuff in the upper room discourse, do you now believe? We just listened to you, Lord. Of course you believe. Why is he asking this? Okay. Because there's other things we need to believe. There's more words than just the good news that we have to actually apply to our lives. Okay? And so if you really do, verse 32, behold, the hour cometh, and God's talking to us right now. Okay? Yea, is now come, that ye shall be scattered, every man to his own, and shall leave me alone. The Lord's in heaven right now. He ain't here. Okay? And yet I am not alone, because the Father is with me. These things have I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. God wants to take you from having peace with God to actually manifesting the peace of God, which passeth all understanding in your life. That comes through tribulation. Okay? In the world you shall have tribulation, guaranteed. It's going to happen if you want to be a disciple. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. Amen. Okay? What's the victory that we have over the world? Okay? It's even our faith. And so live it out. And then Jesus Christ in Hebrews 12, verse 2, Paul says that Jesus Christ is the author and finisher in our faith. And the reason for that is because of the joy that he was set before him, he endured that cross, despising the shame. He welcomed that tribulation knowing the result. Okay? And had peace, had the peace of God in that moment to get through that whole situation and come out with the victory. And you can have it too. Okay? And so then Paul After that glory and tribulations there, he describes what's going on. He says, look, knowing that tribulation leads to patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. Okay? Remember that because you're justified, you have the victory. Okay? 1 Corinthians 15, verse 57 says, I thank God that who giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Something like that. And that's true. He's the reason why we have the victory. But notice, a lot of people, a lot of Christians will pray for the Lord, give me more patience, Lord. Okay? Lord, I need more hope. Okay, help me to have more experience. Okay, and what they forget is the other stuff before that. That order is very, very important. You're not going to get patience if you don't have tribulation. That's where you learn it. That's where God carries you through and he bears the burden with you. You're in the yoke with him. And he carries 99.999999% of the weight. Okay? That's what's required. And because of that patience, you're going to get that experience. And it's going to allow you to see Jesus, who is your hope. See? Go to James 1. James puts it a different way here. James chapter 1. He adds a little meat to that little framework, those bones there from Paul. James 1. And verse 2, the Bible says, my brethren, count it all joy when ye fall into divers temptations. What? I should be excited by that? Yeah. Okay. Apparently the joy of the Holy Ghost involves the reality of you partaking in tribulation for your Savior. Okay. Knowing this. This is why, see that? He's giving you knowledge. That the trying of your faith worketh patience. That's why. The tribulations are needed to try your faith and to help you come out as gold, to help you recognize the reality of the faith you have in God in your heart, in your life, in your walk. So then, verse 4, but let patience have her perfect work, okay, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. Mature Christianity, where you achieve that perfection, okay, where you can say, just like David, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. You can say that from the heart because you've allowed God to work patience and experience into your life and walk. And you know he's going to be there because he's proved it and you've seen it. Not just when you got saved, because many people get saved and then they forget after a while, they're not living for God. Okay? They don't even remember. Okay? But when you live for God, that faith grows. Your faith increases. Okay? And so, Christian, what I'm trying to show you is that if you want patience, don't think that God's just going to automatically take contention and anger that people have against you away. Okay? He's going to show you how to deal with that in those moments so that they don't affect you and you don't desire to be defensive and try to argue back and name call too. That's when it gets manifest. You are just patient the way God is. Okay? How much did the Lord hear when he was getting spit on and buffeted in that false trial? Let me ask you that question. He didn't say a thing. All that was unjust. Every single thing. And when he did speak, the one time when he said, yeah, I am, look what happened. People fell on their back and everything. Okay? You don't want God speaking to you. It's scary. Okay? Not like that. Okay? If you're his enemy, that's what happened. Now the hope. Philippians 3. Philippians 3 verse 10. Why does the hope not make you ashamed? Okay. Well, in Philippians 3, Paul tells you his goal in life, his prize, the high calling he has and what he wants to manifest here, if I could find it. Philippians 3, verse 10, he desires, and he already knows the Lord, but this is going to sound weird, that I may know him. What are you talking about? Okay. Well, I know about Joe Biden, but I don't know him the way his wife does. Okay. Thank God for that. But the idea is, okay, he wants to have an intimate, close relationship with Jesus to be like one of those that are in the inner circle. Okay, he wants to know him. He wants to, like it says there, and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings. Notice he welcomes the tribulation, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. He'd like to get as close to Jesus as he can, knowing that, yes, he couldn't fulfill the work, but he'd like to manifest the Lord so much that people look at him and see Jesus, okay? Who really did rise from the dead because he had no sin or guile in his mouth. and you live that way. See? That's why the hope makes you not ashamed. Because now the love of God, which is in Jesus Christ, has shed abroad in your heart, it comes out. That's the state you want. You want to be so full of the Spirit of God that He overflows like a river and comes out. Seeing Jesus. So all that, all those cool illustrations are about. Okay. And so I got ahead of myself. I'll just skip here. I put there, and hope maketh not ashamed. In Psalm 25, it tells you that you're not ashamed because you've trusted in the Lord to help you get victory over your enemies. You can read those verses in the Psalms later. Okay. Go to 1 John 3. Let's look at the love of God. 1 John 3. Notice what the Apostle John says. Because your desire is for that love of God to be seen. That's why the hope that you have, you're not ashamed of Him. Okay, I want people to know that I believe in the Jesus of the Bible. People know the difference, trust me. Okay? And the Apostle John says, 1 John 3, verse 16, a parallel to John 3, 16. Okay? Hereby perceive we the love of God. How do you recognize it here on earth? Okay? Because He, Jesus, laid down His life for us. God, Jesus is God. There's a good proof verse right there. Okay? I'm amazed when people don't recognize Jesus as God. There you go. How did God lay down His life if He wasn't Jesus? Explain that to me. Okay? And we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. You saw that in the Lord, you should do that for your brethren as well. And give yourself to them. Okay? And so, in 2 Corinthians 5, verse 14, you'll find out that the love of Christ is what constrains you to live for God. Because Christ being dead to all, or the fact that He died for all, okay? And you recognize that you're part of that, you want to live for Him because now He's in life. And so you desire to be part of that ministry of reconciliation. And like it says in verse 20 there of 2 Corinthians 5, you are beseeching others to be reconciled to God. Okay? Unless you laying down your life for them. Because you're telling them something that you know is going to result in antagonism. Or it's going to result in disdain. And you're going to be despised for it. Okay? I didn't like it when somebody told me I couldn't make myself get to heaven in some way. That I needed somebody else. Okay? But it's true. Truth hurts. Okay? But it's good for you. Go back to Romans 5, please. Romans 5. There's plenty of positive examples of pain. I mean, we all know it. We all appreciate our reflexes when we touch a hot stove, for example. Okay? Very important. And so now we're in Romans 5, okay? And what we've seen in these first five verses are all these great spiritual blessings that we have in Christ Jesus. But the reality is most people who are actually saved completely ignore these things and don't apply them to their lives. And it's for that reason they're carnal. It's for that reason they're confused. And that's sad, right? Why didn't they just read Romans 5 and believe it? I don't know. That's what I did, okay? I already believed in the gospel. I might as well believe the rest of the word of God. Right? I mean, I know you saved my soul. Some things are that simple. Okay? Thank God for that. Romans 5, verse 6. Romans 5, verse 6. Let's see if I can get through this one. For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely a righteous man will one die. Yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commendeth His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. There's that famous verse. But notice the context. It's showing you the difference between God and the rest of us. Okay. Looking at verses, notice it said that we were yet without strength. Okay. Now what is that talking about? As somebody who was not born again, you are dead in trespasses and sins. You have no capacity in your spirit to serve and live for God. You're without strength. Okay? And for those that study, the first great commandment talks about heart, soul, mind, and strength. Now you know what that's referring to. It's referring to your spirit. Okay? lot of people wonder what that's about. Learn that from Brother Curtis over there in Ohio, another preacher who taught me that. Good stuff. Okay. We were without strength in our spirit. We had no capacity for God. But yet the Lord died for ungodly people like us. Okay. And then you get the reality of these people being ungodly. Why are we ungodly? Okay. Well, we don't have God. That's what it means. But what you have to recognize is that you're a sinner. Okay. The Lord, in Luke 5, he said he didn't come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Talking to sinners who didn't think they were sinners. Okay. He was talking to religious leaders. And he was a great physician. He's like, look, do you recognize you're sick? If you don't know you're sick, you're not going to be able to get healed. You're not going to receive the medication. Okay? But that same God in Luke 19, verse 10, he said he will come to seek and save that which was lost. And he thought about each and every one of us before we even existed. Praise the Lord. Okay? So as a person who is lost, as a person who is an unbeliever, a person who is ungodly, pick whatever term you want based on the context. If somebody needs to hear the hard word, tell them they're ungodly sinners. If you want to be soft, tell them, hey, you're an unbeliever. Do what you got to do. The Lord will lead you. But they need to recognize that truth, that they're without strength, that they can't do anything to go to heaven. Okay? That's when you place true faith in Jesus Christ, because you've accepted the true testimony, like we saw in Romans 3, that you are a sinner, that you're guilty before God, and only He can fix it. And so verse 7 shows you the reality that we can understand people dying for family members, we can understand people dying for good friends that they have, or dying for people at work that are acquaintances, but you want to help them because you care about them and you value their presence. But dying for your enemy that spits in your face and knocks you down on the ground is a whole different situation. Okay? That's what God did for us. Okay? And so in verse 8, we see that God is currently commendeth. Commendeth. F is actually present tense. Commends. So God commends his love toward us. See that? Why does he do that? Well, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, right? That whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And who he's commending today to people and showing his love, he's commending Jesus to them, showing them the Son of God. Do you see my Son the way you're supposed to? Okay. I'm trying to show you my goodness, because the goodness of God leads you to repentance. And God's goodness is his Son. Go to Psalm 16. Psalm 16. What I want to show you here in Psalm 16, this is a messianic psalm. It's one of David's psalms, but he's not really talking about himself. He's talking about the Messiah. And I want you to notice what the Messiah said in his soul. Okay? So you can see God was really thinking about you. Because you can think in your heart, the Bible says. Okay? Physically, and I need to check this, it's been a while, but I could have sworn they found certain types of cells in your heart that have correlation to nerve cells in the brain. Okay? So if you can think there. But the Bible does say in your spiritual heart, in the part of your soul, yeah, you think. Okay? That's what drives your personality. That's your character. Okay? And in Psalm 16, verse 1, it says, preserve me, O God, for in thee do I put my trust. Okay? And then it says, O my soul, thou hast said unto the Lord, okay? And if we study this, we'll find out that this is David's spirit talking about what his soul's saying. Okay? The only way that makes sense contextually. But notice what's going on here. Okay? So this is really the Lord who could say this. Thou art my Lord. Okay? Jesus talking to his Father and his soul. My goodness, notice, extendeth not to thee. Why does he even extend to God? But to the saints that are in the earth, and to the excellent, in whom is all my delight. Jesus Christ intends his goodness to extend to you if you allow him to make you a saint. Yeah. And so God the Father shows that goodness to every person, shows Jesus to them so that they could come to repent. See that? And when they do that, then Jesus Christ's goodness can become power of their lives. That's that grace of God. Okay. How does God commend his love? Well, that's why you got the street preachers out there. That's why you got the tracts out there. That's why you got the signs out there. That's why you got the one-on-ones. That's why God gave you family so you can witness to them. Okay? Every single example of evangelism that exists. Even that tract that somebody threw on the floor and somebody else picks up and reads has the power of God all over it. Because the Word of God is in there. God will do everything in His power to at least show that to every single person. They may not understand all the rest of the Bible or anything, but God can take any verse here in Scripture and show them their need for Jesus Christ. And in fact, He wants to train you to do that too. Paul can do that anywhere. He'll get to Jesus. Because they don't testify of eternal life, right? They testify of Jesus, Jesus said. They are they which testify of me. Romans 5. Romans 5. Simplicity in Christ. Showing Jesus. Showing the love of God. Now, as I say, there's actually discussions among Bible believers about the love of God, you know. Does God show love to lost people now? Does He love them, like, directly? Or is it something that happened in the past? How does that work? Okay. And I guess the difference between the two is tied directly to how they view the situation with Jesus. Okay. They all kind of cross at that point there. Verse 9, Romans 5, verse 9. Much more than, okay. So now that you've recognized that God did this for you, much more than being now justified by His blood. See, notice He's saying, look, you got it now. Okay? You're good, son of brethren. We shall, future from that, be saved from wrath through Him. For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of His Son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by His life. And not only so. But we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement. Okay, and I'm stressing all this now, shall stuff for a reason. Okay? Many of us will read this and just think, oh, now that we've been justified, we're safe from wrath. We're not going to hell. Okay? Amen to that. Okay? But that's not what it's talking about. Okay? It's talking about some wrath that's to come. Wrath in the future. Okay? As close as your current walk and beyond, and as far as even the rapture, like we discussed last week, you shall receive an imputation. So He's continuing to build this in there. He's working on that. Okay. Major items. Verse 9. Notice that we're saved from wrath. Okay. For the sake of time, go to Ephesians 6. Ephesians 6. In Nahum 1 verse 2, you find out that God had reserved His wrath for His enemies. Are you God's enemy? Super saints think that certain Christians are. So they think they're going to end up, you know, staying here for the wrath of God, the time of Jacob's trouble. Okay? Because they need to get fixed or something. Okay? That's complete nonsense. You're not God's enemy anymore. You've been justified. You have peace with God. So how does God's wrath apply to you? Or to any other saint, no matter how carnal they are. Okay? If you want to look at carnality, read the Old Testament. There's plenty with Israel. Okay? It's kind of crazy. Ephesians 6, verse 4. God giving a command to fathers. Okay? So talking to me. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath. I shouldn't be doing that. Okay? But bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, notice, admonishing, telling them what's different, the right and wrong, and helping them grow. Allowing them to discern the difference is not wrath, okay? But provoking them to wrath for doing the wrong things and overjudging and all this to where they hate you, that's a problem, okay? And if God is telling fathers to do that, what makes you think He's going to do that with His kids? He's a perfect father. So why are so many Christians saying that we're going to end up in the wrath of God? It makes no sense, okay? Oh, it's not the wrath of God, it's the wrath of Satan. It's the second part of the trib or whatever. Okay. God is over all that. Okay? You could argue the same thing for the fact that you used to fear death. Okay, the wrath of God abided in us when we were lost. Okay? Satan was involved with all that. Okay? It's a weird argument. Okay. Go to 1 Thessalonians 5. 1 Thessalonians 5. The reason why Paul isn't specific is because later on he gets into specifics and it really just blanket applies to any kind of wrath. Okay, that's why. You're not appointed to it, okay? In the near term, okay, as you walk with God and adjust and work on your state to become more like His Son today. 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 9. Remember, we talk about putting on the breastplate and the helmet, right? Then it says for, so this is why you do it. For God hath not appointed us to wrath. Once again, blanket. But to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, if you're a sleeping carnal Christian, this applies to you too. We should live together with Him. So if you're asleep, wake up. If you're awake, stay up. Okay. Preacher was sleeping there as well, but anyways, wherefore comfort yourselves together. Yeah, I do it too. It's hard, man. Them seats are too comfortable, preacher. We gotta get some hard ones. Anyways, and edify one another, even as also ye do. So because you know this, you're going to work and comfort the other brethren and try to edify them and help each other grow so we can manifest and obtain the salvation promised to us in our walk. That's our sanctification. See that? Because you're not appointed. The wrath of God doesn't abide on you now. You can live for God now. You can manifest parts of heaven here on earth today. And if there's one place that should be heaven to you, it should be your home. Isn't that the common saying? Well, you can actually do that, Christian. Praise God. That's how I feel when I get home. I get tired of work, man. Whew. Trust me. But then, 1 Thessalonians 1. 1 Thessalonians 1 and verse 9, we get some specificity now, leading to the far term, which is tied to the adoption. Okay, why are we going to get adopted? Why is our body going to get redeemed and pulled out of here? Okay, it's because 1 Thessalonians 1 verse 9, for they themselves show of us what manner of entering in we had unto you, and how ye turned to God from idols to serve a living and true God. That's you. Okay, I turned from plenty of idols from Catholicism, okay, and from me. Okay, that was my biggest idol, was me worshiping myself. And to wait for His Son from heaven, whom He raised from the dead, even Jesus, which delivered us from the wrath to come. That's the time of Jacob's trouble. Okay? God is the one that's opening those seals. Did you know that? I don't know why people ignore that. Okay, the beasts are just telling you what's going on. It's the Lamb. He's got the book. He's the one that opens it. Well, who are the Jews under wrath? Because they haven't been born again yet. Okay, God's working with them to try to purify them. Going to wake up. That's not you, Christian. So why do you think you're going in that time? It's very strange. And the reason why you shall be saved from the wrath is because God has a promise. He's going to impute something to your body. Give you the glorious body. That's He's building into that once again. Okay. And then it says, oh, because when you were enemies, you were reconciled to God by Jesus. Then being reconciled, present tense, you shall be saved by His life. Let me show you something about that. 2 Corinthians 5. Little nugget here. Okay. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 18. Notice Paul says, and all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to Himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation, to wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto Himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. God did everything He could with mankind. Okay? Through Jesus, He was able to set things up to where He could work with anybody, Jew or Gentile alike, to try to get them saved. That's His part of reconciliation. But we have to go out and preach that ministry so that others can be reconciled to God and they turn around and recognize what Jesus did. Okay? Now the nugget. Not imputing their trespasses unto them. God is not holding the trespasses of the world unto their account, because if He did, we'd all be dead. Okay? He is holding that back and trying to be merciful despite our unbelief, working with us. Why trespasses? For those who know, a trespass is a sin of ignorance. Okay? And the one biggest sin of ignorance for every Gentile is the fact that we're not circumcised. That doesn't count. The middle wall partition has been wiped out for those who need the doctrine. That's the depth of it. And then the last verse, which we'll just do quick. It says in verse 11 there that now we've received the atonement. Okay? This is why we can enter into the throne of God. Glory to God. What is the atonement? Okay, read Leviticus all over the place. Okay. It's a nice, cool word in English. At one man. God made it so that two that were separate could become one and join together. And that was done through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. The verse I have there talks about the Day of Atonement, where Aaron, the high priest, would go in there and do all this stuff in order to bring reconciliation to the people. But that cleansing that happened only worked for a year. He had to do it again and again every year. Jesus Christ went into the most holy place in heaven and did it once forever. That's the difference. Okay. And now that you've received it, take those results of justification and apply them to your life. Live for God. That's what Paul's trying to focus on. Okay, so we'll go ahead and pray and open up for questions. Amen. Because I'm already taking too long. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for showing us the results of justification, Lord, and just help us, Lord, to allow the love of God to be shed abroad in our hearts and to manifest through our lives by the power of your Spirit, Lord. Help us to desire to work on our state so we can become more like your Son here today. Help us in those moments of trial where we need you for comfort, okay, and for grace, Lord. And we give you thanks and praise for all these things, but especially for the salvation that you gave through your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Any questions or comments this morning? All right. Pretty straightforward today. And controversy next week. I'm going to get yelled at by people.